exam?
No, he used the facility. He went to use the facility.
Oh, okay.
It's supposed to be really hot this week, though.
Yeah.
Nineties. Eighties and nineties, start everything up again.
Right on me.
We will call this meeting back to order. It's 1:30, working agenda. Corey Swanson, county attorney, pending county issues. Come on up, Corey. This is a working agenda, but we do have a decision right after it, so we can go ahead and act on that should we decide to.
Well, Commissioners, thanks for, I guess we'll give this a few tries and then either it'll be really good or we'll quit doing it. I don't know. Appreciate the time to just kind of go through some things.
Can we start maybe with the unfinished business from last week and then move on to the new, or would you rather start with the new information? We don't have a 3 o'clock today, so we can do whatever you want.
I'm fine either way. Either way. So, whatever you want to do. Whatever's your pleasure.
All right. Any preference from the commission?
No.
All right. Do you want to start in then, Nick, with what
yeah.
you found on the phone bills so that we can maybe take care of old stuff and move on to new stuff?
That works. So, was able to get the four claims that were paid fiscal year February 14, fiscal year 13 and 14, and then 15, 16. There was none in 14, 15. So I went through and as we discussed in the last meeting, trying to figure out the difference between why these bills were paid and then these other ones were not. So these four here, as I went through the stack and looked through everything, very minimal information, these four. So you have 6, 12, 16, 2, 28, 14, 1, 22, 14, 5, 1, 14. Those ones did not have the same amount of information going off the standard of what these the paid claims were. So I used these as the standard of why these claims were paid. And these four claims did not meet that standard. If you look at these claims, they have two, sometimes three pages of his Verizon bill. And those ones did not meet the same standards of what he had turned in. On the other hand, these claims that we have here are the exact same information turned in that these paid claims were. So I have these four that were paid, paid because he turned in a claim that had a Verizon bill, and it had four or two front and back or three pages for a Verizon bill that he received. So when I look at these, because they were paid as a standard, these 11 met that standard. These four do not meet that standard. So that's what I found out with the cell phone. There's no rhyme or reason. There's no difference between the four that were paid and the 11 that were not. I couldn't find a discrepancy in the two. So that's what I found in the cell phone area.
Nick, each here has.
Yeah, but if you look here, Franklin, these have a lot more information.
Okay, so on these here, that's when Over says, well, you gotta have There's four pages. So then I got to looking, and they were front and back, so that's why a couple of these probably don't have that front and back on this.
Right,
but,
and
but
so
everything's been the same.
Right, and all I'm saying, all I had was the information given to me at hand. So when I went through and looked at, okay, let's find out why these four were paid. And the only reason why I can find that these four were paid is because they had a total of four more, two front and back, so four pages or a third page. As some of these, he did do all four pages, so there's more than that. So he had a total of five pages on some of them. So
because I couldn't make a copy.
So
if he was a copy, I couldn't make. I have.
Right. So these, this stack that was paid is the same information of this 11. These four do not meet the standards set by the ones that were paid. Does anyone follow me so far?
This one here, Nick, is this is the total. That's why I put that in. The total was this in here, so I didn't have any. All these are in.
Okay. So taking the what taken away from the claims that they had paid and looking at the claims of these cell phone, that they all have the same amount of information.
So what are you recommending?
Because if we go off the standard, that the reason why these were paid is because they felt at the time that had enough information. I don't know. I'm just going off because of they were paid. Then my recommendation would be to pay these 11 because they have the same amount of information as these four. There's no difference whatsoever. So that would be my recommendation. If this is the standard because these four got paid with this amount of information, then these should be paid because they have the same amount of information during the same window of time.
Actually, every one of the 16, all of them have the same thing. Other, there's a couple of whatever you said that wasn't sure on that right there. Okay, here's the claim. There's the bill. Okay, that's what I start off with. I just put in this one because it shows everything there. And there is stuff on the back, and it kept saying it should have to be four pages. So that's when I realized it was front and back. And that's what I turned in. So everything's actually the same. I got them all here. I mean, other than those couple there that had the,
but all, just the one all I can say, Franklin, is the reason why I can see why these were not paid is because they don't have the same exact information that these ones do. They're not there. So if you ask me to look at this and investigate why these were paid, why these claims were paid is because you had four or more pages of information. These have one. You get one page of information. Each one of these is one page. So that's why I can say, okay, during the same period of time, these have four pages, these have one page. These have four more pages, just like these have four more pages. So that's why during the same window of time, they all meet the same standards of the four that were paid.
Yeah, see, everyone's ever been turned in. Here's the claim. Pages to their front and back. Everyone has been that other than those first two over there.
Right, that's what I mean.
So they're actually all the same.
Okay, but they're not. What you turned in was one page. What you turned in here was four pages. So they are not the same.
Well, I said, okay, those two have only got the two.
Right.
But from there on, all of them and all of them.
That's what I'm saying.
Yeah.
That's what I'm saying.
So you're disputing those two then?
Yeah, I'm disputing these because they do not match. These 11 match because what was paid in this one is the same one that this one was denied. If you look at these two, take them page by page, they're the same thing. There's not an itemized list. There's not any of that information. It's just an entire phone bill minus the call log.
And I I appreciate the work you did on this. I am fine with whatever you want to decide on that. Our standard was actually the call log, because that's what Elaine and I and the previous commission were submitting.
Sure, I never got a call. This is what I got right here every month.
And
I also like to add to the people out there too, how this started. The judge was doing this, Judge Olson, previous judge. He just turned in $20 claim, and I got a copy of it right here every month. And so he made me a copy before he left office, because I said, hey, I might need this. And also on Bill Flinder, which everybody knows all about now, but didn't at that time. This is the second month after he is on administrative leave. I put a sticky note on the claim and said, why does Flinder still have a county phone? Well, I just got all kinds of heck about it, because I suppose I was harassing the employees. So anyway, then I got right over here too, a copy of, I think it was August of his. He went on administrative leave in June. It's either August or September. He had 300 or so phone calls and 30 or 40 texts. His phone bill is still being paid. He wasn't to have any county equipment whatsoever. I think he had his phone right till the end, until he finally resigned in December.
Can I make an observation?
Yes.
So the one that was paid here was find the date range.
There are four.
April 14th to May 13th. $38.64.
Well, no. That was my total bill. I only charged $20 each month.
Okay, so you're just requesting a $20 reimbursement.
Right.
The point is that that appears to be $37.81 is the previous balance. Okay. So that bill shows that month time period, it shows the monthly charge, and then the last page shows what it shows is for calling minutes, 291 minutes used, mobile, 212 minutes, and then night weekend 85 minutes. And those were all done within that plan where there's no extra charges. I don't even know if they do that anymore. They used to, but and then for text messages he received 5, sent none, apparently. So that's the one that was paid. The one that's not paid is the month right before that, which is March 14th, April 13th. And it shows the date range and then the monthly charge of $37.81. And then it doesn't show this last page of minutes used in text messages. So in terms of the number of pages, that's really the only, that's the additional information that this one has. So I think so long as the commission makes it, you know, clear and reliable in terms of the criteria that you're using, and it sounds like what I think you're suggesting is they paid it at this time with this much information, so it would not be correct at this point to ask for more information beyond this when they said clearly at this point that was enough information to provide the $20. Is that what you're saying?
Right. The only, and even if, so if there was the stipulation of the call log, and I guess this is where, you know, Chairman Olbert is, you know, stated on several occasions, it's never changed. And even in my time here, you know, the call log was the issue. Throughout looking into this and the investigation of this, what I was anticipating seeing is all four of these have call logs on them. But that's not what I found.
Right.
So even if that is the standard that we are in, and I'm okay with that standard, but that's not what was paid. That standard was not what was paid. So I have to hold this as the standard and pay the ones that meet that same criteria, pay those as well. These, like you said, these are missing a page. So these do not meet that criteria. So that's why I'm disputing those, because if this is the standard, then we have to follow that standard.
So how many are there that you're suggesting not?
I believe that there's three here that's not three. Yeah, three, a total of three.
Okay. So we're talking $60.
Correct. Just to, for the record to show, anybody out there can see it too, here's what the judge turned in every time. He turned up the claim like I did right here, and the other side he always put down. Personal cell phone use, and he's right here. This is what I have turned in since the beginning of being paid for my part on all phone bills. And he signed that 7/31/14. Like, before he's gonna go out of office, I said, hey, I want some proof of if you had to do anything else different. So anyway, and then I got to hear this Bill Fleiner thing. And Fleiner had a phone. Of course, all that's going to be coming up again. This is a big thing that's taking place. The FBI.
So, Commissioner Slipka, what I hear, I don't think it's a motion yet, but it's heading toward a motion, I'm guessing, is that Commissioner Korthals says he would support paying all of those outstanding claims except for three, because three of them didn't have as much documentation as the ones that during that same period when you guys were arguing about it, that the commission did pay them with not your full call log, but with more information mm-hmm. from your phone bill. So do you have your opinion on that?
Like I said, that one page doesn't make a difference, but to simplify it, I'd go along with those three.
So paying the, how many total?
There's more than that.
11.
You don't have any 16 on there.
No, this is the bills that have been denied, that have not been claimed. These are all the ones that have claims that have been submitted that have not been paid.
Okay, where's 16's in there? They've been turned in every month. Every month they've been turned in.
This is just the file that was provided to me. So
anyway,
I have.
What are the dates here?
Oh, sorry. Yeah, that's all right. So you have 8.
And also to you people out there in the audience, maybe I already said it, whatever the phone bill is, it's just a straight $20. So some of them are 37, some are 44, and sometimes no matter what. I did just like the judge, I just put a flat $20. And besides that, the road crew come in and they wanted reimbursed on their phones. So, and they wanted to go back 3 years. So they wanted $20 a month reimbursement. I went along with it, or we didn't, but I wouldn't go back, they wouldn't go back 3 years. And this was in the spring of the year, and I said, I will go back till the first of the year. So every 6 months, they turn in a claim of $120. I see there's one in here that Wynn turned in for $120 for 6 months.
Sorry, I should
have been every these. Month that bill's been turned in up here, a claim. They're not there.
So you have January of 15. You have June of 15.
Those are the ones I got paid on.
No, these are the ones I got not paid. Got paid. July of 15, August of 15, and October of 15 that have not been paid. Then you have January of 14, December of 14, September of 14, and June of 14. And one of 16, so January of 16, February of 16. So 14, 15, and 16.
So from there was, so September of 15 was missing, and then after October of 15, was there November and December of 15?
Nope. And you have a January, February of 16.
March onward, you don't have.
Correct. Well, we have a paid claim of June of 16.
That's, no, June of 16.
Yeah.
Okay, that's the one that's approved here that.
Yep.
Meeting.
Yeah. June of 16 is paid.
So actually what the bills so are, there's 14, 15, and 16 up to that June one, minus the ones that have been paid. And if I go ahead and say the other three.
So December of 15.
You do that?
Yep, it's paid.
It's paid.
Yep. And then June of 14 is paid. And March of 14 is paid. March, June of 14 was paid. And November of 15 was paid. And June of 16 was paid.
Do you submit one in September of 2015?
Every month.
Check that one. I think that's one.
This is just a piece of paper in there.
That was an issue, a different issue.
Okay.
The individual's phone bill does not come up to $20. It's $17, so it's not
higher than
the reimbursement.
Yep.
So that's totally different.
Yeah, thank you.
So did you submit March of 2016, April and May?
Yeah, March. All of 14 was submitted, all of 15 and 16 up until, well, it's still been way up till May, I guess it was.
Well, June was paid, so you haven't done until
late. Yeah, so that's what it stopped.
So there's four here, September of 2015, and then March, April, May of 2016 that he said he submitted that are not in your file.
And none of 16 is in there.
Yeah, well, he said January, February were paid. Is that right?
No, June was paid of 16.
Not January, February?
No, those are claims that have not
been paid. Oh, they're here, though.
They're here.
Okay.
Yeah. Gotcha. And I think I made a statement, I have to go back in the minutes of our last meeting. Someone made a statement of not always having the claim done because he didn't get paid in the past. I was very open about not paying the claims that were not handed in.
I think you're the one that mentioned that, that there was a lapse in the claims.
Well, I would say based on this that that's not, that some of these are being paid. So this has not been a constant. Well, when were they paid? When were January, February? They're in the deal. Okay, so they have
yes.
been paid. So when was the last one that was paid prior to this spring? It would have been
the one prior paid prior to this.
Yeah,
would have been. December of 15.
December 15.
November of 15.
December onward to.
November of 15 was paid. That's okay. The only month. November.
Okay, November was paid.
October was not.
October? No, November of 15 was the only one that was paid. Then you have. Then you go down to 14.
Oh, really?
Yep.
And when was November paid? At the time?
Yeah, December, yeah. November 11/30, 15. Total paid.
Can I get, see where I've got? I've got them all. I didn't bring 16, but I didn't bring 14. I just 15 go whatever I want.
So what do you want to do?
These are the claims I have in front of me. So I asked for all the claims. These were all the claims that were given to me. So until I see, I mean, obviously we're held to this standard. But these are the claims I have before me, these 11. So my motion is to pay these 11. That's what I have in front of me right now. I can't testify or look into anything that I don't have in front of me.
So 2.5 years, correct?
Can I just?
Yeah.
Call up these months. So this is January 2016, February 2016, October 2015, August. This might be July because it's the beginning of August. It is. July of 2015. This is May of 2015. April 2015. This is January of 2015. August of 2014. Appears to have a cover page on it that's for a different date. Cover page doesn't match the bill.
What month was that?
What's the building and what's the cover page date, Corey, on that one that doesn't match?
Part of the problem is it's carrying over some past due charges. No, it's not. They're paid.
Shouldn't there be a past due charge? It goes right through the bank. I never, they sent me this copy after, but.
Okay, so the bill is for July of 2013, and it looks like it was submitted January of 2014. Make sense? So that's just when he submitted. November of 2014. September 2013.
Uh-huh. Okay.
And June of 2014.
Corey, the 9/13 bill, what's the claim date on that one?
Hang on.
Sorry, I should have asked at the time.
You want September or August?
You said September of 2013.
That was one with the cover plate.
All right. Here we go. September of 2013. Is that what you're saying?
Yeah, and what's the claim date?
Hang on. No, I read the date of that month. I got that wrong. I'm sorry. It was September of 2015. You have that one on the list?
Okay. But it's the claim date is what I wrote down.
Claim date is submitted this October 1st of 2015.
Okay.
And it was for the month of September of 2015.
Okay. The 13th for me.
I think I said 13 because that was the day of the month that I got. So does that 11 months? Have we got that on track?
Yes.
And then you have June. February, January, February, and May of 14 that did not have the same information. So January, February, and May did not have the standards documentation.
Okay. We'll take your comments in a little bit. This is a working meeting.
Chair, there is a motion on the floor. There is no second to it.
Oh, I'm sorry. I didn't hear the motion.
It's because I was trying to name each of the months in the motion. That's why it took so long.
Okay. Nick moved to pay the 11 claims that he has examined.
Thank you very much. Do you have a second to the motion, Franklin?
No, because what's the, there's all together been 29 months, four have been paid, unless these three that I said that go along with, so that leaves 21 months, so how many you got there?
We have 11.
So there's a whole year, it's not even a year and a half, I guess.
Well, there's four that I'm listed here that you said you had paid, but had not. They're not in the stack, have been submitted but haven't been paid and are not in the stack.
Okay, we do have a motion on the floor. I'm going to second the motion. Do you guys want to continue discussion?
Well, how many months are we going to be paid for? That's what I want to know.
This would be 11 months right now.
Okay.
I wouldn't understand that motion to preclude all other payments. These are just the ones that are here before the commission right now.
And I would actually defer to Nick on what he said. If there isn't a claim that was submitted, I wouldn't be for paying something that now we'll get a bunch. If it was submitted and based on the criteria that you guys have come up with, which is fine, we're going to go ahead and pay all these claims, but only the ones that were submitted. If they weren't submitted, I think we now defer to the phone policy that we put together.
Why don't we do this one issue at a time? That's a separate issue.
I agree.
Why don't we deal with this vote?
This is just for those claims. Yes, these claims.
But this would impliedly reject three of those claims, just so you're tracking. Are you tracking that?
No, watch that now.
This would reject three of the claims. Is that accurate?
Correct.
This would reject the three that he said didn't have sufficient documentation.
Okay.
So if you guys want to sever that into two motions, do you want to do that?
Okay, so
we're getting fancy here. We'll get the Robert's rules.
I'll make a motion that
We have a motion on the floor, so do you want to
I'll recant. Yeah, I'll resend
my second.
Initial.
Go ahead.
So these three do not have the same supporting document of that which were paid.
Okay.
So I'll make a motion to not pay these because they do not meet the standard.
Can you tell us the months that you're in?
Yes. May of 14, June of 14, and February of 14.
What's the other one, Nick?
May, January, and February.
Of 14.
Yes, sir.
So is your motion not to pay those three?
Correct.
Okay, do we have a second to the motion? I'll second the motion. Any further discussion? Okay. The motion is that we will not be paying January, February, and May of 2014 as those claims do not meet the standards set. All those in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed?
I still ask you for the total amount that's going to be paid. And you're saying it's only 11.
No, that's not what we're saying. So the motion right now is to reject three payments for a total of $60. May.
Okay.
January and February of 2014. That's the only vote on the floor right now.
I already said that. If there was only just that one page, which shouldn't make any difference, but I'd go along with that to clarify that part. That's the only reason. And if I have to vote against it, I will, but I mean, that's...
So is that vote nay?
I'm abstaining on that.
Okay.
All right.
Because it all might go to a lot higher up.
Okay, so let the record show... motion carries with Franklin abstaining.
Okay. Now, when I asked for all the information, this was the information that was given to me. all the claims in regards to Commissioner Slivka were given to me in this file. Okay, I have 11 cell phone bills that I was able to look at, go through, and see the difference between these 11 that were not paid and the four that were paid. There's no difference. So this being the standard, these not being paid, okay? And we have a whole list of them for that we've already gone through already. I don't think I'm missing any. The rest of them are mileage and other reimbursements.
Could I interrupt for a second?
Yes.
I just realized that we need to allow public comment on this issue because we are taking votes.
You're right.
And so,
you're right. These votes.
It sounds like there's going to be at least two more votes coming, but this might be an appropriate time for some public comment before we do more votes.
Let's go ahead and move the agenda on to Commissioner Franklin Slivka, payments for personal cell phone and mileage decision. Thank you. We're out of the working agenda then. So, we'll go ahead and take comments. Thank you.
Sorry, Wayne. It dawned on me, but I was a little slow.
Wayne Holm. Anyway. I don't understand why we're having a problem over a $400. And Friday night, they wound up spending $9,000 for 176 pieces of paper that are going to be completely worthless. Most of the public's right with me. So that's where I'm having the problem here.
What 176 pieces of paper?
Well, the guy promised them two sheets of paper per employee.
This Larson Associates that come in that matrix thing on Friday.
Oh, I thought you meant Friday night when we were doing that search warrant
until
midnight. I was on word and paper there. Sorry.
All right, Shirley. Shirley Wilson. I have a question. So Franklin charges you $20 a month for his phone bill. How much do you charge, Laura, and how much do you charge, Nick? And what's the issue here?
They have county phones, Shirley.
So how much do we pay for them?
I'm thinking that probably $45, $50. I don't know.
I noticed in the phone book, Mrs. Overt does not have a landline listed.
I should. It should be in there. I purposely keep a landline for
it
this purpose.
It is not in the new phone book.
That's good to know. Thank you.
I didn't know whether your cell phone was your only form of communication or not. I did not look up Mr. Korthal's. But what do we pay each of you per month for a phone?
Nothing. You don't pay me anything for a phone. I carry two cell phones. My personal cell phone, which I pay out of my own pocket. Then a county cell phone that the county pays.
But how much does the county pay? I guess that's my question. Is Franklin's $20 similar or dissimilar to what the county furnishes you and Ms. Over?
Here's the issue, Shirley, since that's the second part of your question. I'm like Nick, nobody pays anything for my personal phone. That's totally on me, as is his. For our public use, for our public calls on county business, our bills are totally open to any member of the public any day of the week that wants to come and look at those. Those are in the accounting office. And that is because it is a county phone. I don't know what the cost is. We have a county plan, so everybody is under one plan. The issue with this was the transparency question. We have a lot of people that want more transparency. A commission prior to this commission, decided that all county commissioners will provide their calls in and out that they make on county business in the accounting office. And that was the reason that the personal cell phone was not paid for Franklin, is because he was not giving that information as the previous commission had set precedent. So the commission at the time said, we are not going to reimburse you this until you provide that transparency. That's the only thing that was holding up. What we learned last week is if there's black and white of a claim being paid, then that actually overrides a precedent of practice. So that's why today, having seen that there were four that were paid, that means that all subsequent bills then will be paid under that standard that Nick has illuminated. So that's the whole story.
But you didn't answer the question.
Okay, so you're asking two different questions, okay? So
I'm asking what the county pays for county-provided phone.
Everyone is stuck on the $20, okay? That is not the issue.
The main difference.
The $20 is not the issue here, okay?
Yes, it is.
No, it's not. Okay, and we can agree to disagree, but what you need to understand is there's a policy and procedure to do things, okay? And certain policy and procedures was not followed. That's why these three claims got denied, because that policy and procedures was not followed. If you want to have a transparency, follow policy and procedures, and that won't hang anything up. It's not the $20. Okay, I'll tell you, $40, okay?
No,
the county pays $40 for my cell phone, $20 for him, so he's saving us $20. Now, if I can't tell you if that $40 is true or not, okay? I can't tell you that. But what I can tell you is I don't have this issue because I carry two cell phones.
But evidently that was approved when he asked to do that. So what's the issue now?
He didn't follow policy and procedure.
Then someone didn't allow him to do it or something, because if I'm understanding correctly, he evidently asked if he could have $20 a month for his cell phone usage without a county phone. Am I on the right track? Someone must have approved that procedure for him to have started and still continue to this point.
So the way that this works, so everyone is clear on the way this works. The county offers those who need cell phones a cell phone. You have law enforcement, Corey.
I don't have one.
Oh, no, but you can through the county. Those that are on call and have to attend to county business off of regular working hours have the ability to have a county cell phone. Mm-hmm. So the county would pay for that. Okay? You can choose through past practices to not have a county cell phone, and there was $20 given to you, okay? So to do that, you had to turn in your cell phone bill, okay? So Judge Olson had to turn in his cell phone bill for $20, okay? The difference that we have here between Judge Olson, a sheriff's deputy, and we went over this last week, is an ongoing investigation for a county deputy, his call log not being public because it's an ongoing investigation. Time and time again, Commissioner, and I'm not against Franklin, so let's make that very clear. I want to get to the bottom and make everything, let's just be uniform. So that's why I suggested these 11 claims being paid, because the standard, regardless of what was said, the standard is in black and white, these were paid. So that's the standard. But somewhere beyond my ears here, someone said $20. Turn in your claim and you'll get reimbursed $20. So because there's never been a cell phone policy ever written, or things of that nature, and how to pay it, if it's monthly, quarterly, bi-quarterly, yearly, nothing like that is, now we're in a situation that it's put to challenge, because we're in a situation where it's being challenged, and going through all the cell phone bills that I have before me and looking at it, okay, I can say that these did not hold to the standard of those being paid. If they don't hold to the standard just because someone turns in a claim that's not held to the standard, we can't pay it. You understand what I'm saying there?
I do.
So
I think there's an awful lot of
money
going
there, on. There, so yeah, so the $20, the county foots the bill for I don't know how many lines. That's just part of your duties as whatever public job you've taken. Commissioner Slifka is not the only person. You have the road department, you have the sheriff, now and the sheriff of the past that had their own personal cell phones. So that's now what we're rectifying is these claims in front of us. Franklin turned in these 11 claims and possibly more, but the only claims that I have before me that I feel comfortable voting on is in what's before me to pay these 11 claims. That's what I feel comfortable in because I can look at them and say, yes, they are to the same standard of the same era. We're not talking about new policy and old policy. This is all the same policy. And that's what I feel comfortable in doing. It's black and white. There's evidence to support the decisions. And that's what the 20, it's not $20. There's policy and procedure that goes along with that $20.
I'll add to that. You wanted to know what they're paying. A Flyner's biller in 9, it'll be September 2nd of 13, the bill was $44.44. And I think that's what my bill usually runs around $45, and I charge the 20. Like you say, most of the time you're saving the county probably $24 a month.
So when he went on paid administrative, or was it paid or unpaid administrative leave?
Unpaid.
Mr. Platter. So when he went on leave, why wasn't his phone collected? I mean, did we shut up his office and take away his key?
It's supposed to be. They put Natalie on at the same time. Natalie called the sheriff. So you come over, you get my cell phone, you get everything I have, she turned everything right over. And I believe it was July, like I just stated. Here's his phone bill comes on Flyner's.
So and I put a stick. What year?
Of this 13 after he was put on ministry. Okay. So I put the sticky note on. I says, why does Flyner still have a county phone? And I caught all kinds of slack from over that I was harassing employees. I should have went to her about everything.
So does he still have the phone?
He had it. As far as I, well, this is in September when I made this one copy. And I know he had it in October because I saw the.
Of 16? I mean, of 13?
13.
Okay, that was 2.5 years ago, or almost three. So do we know if he has the phone now?
It's in the hands of the lawyers, I have no idea. And it was back then too. As soon as all that started, it ended up in the hands of the lawyers, and
well,
I can't answer any questions.
Are not paying the bill though?
No, the county was paying the bill.
No, I know, right now?
He retired 2 years ago.
Yeah, I would think, the FBI knows all this, so the FBI's gonna thrash us all. Okay. Maybe we can get the FBI to reimburse it back.
Point is, it stopped at some point at the end of 2013.
We're way off base here.
Yes.
Can we get back on to?
Yeah, well, just shows, right. It just gives you an idea what was taking place.
Okay. So, anyway, have you now approved the 11 or not yet?
No, we haven't yet. Go ahead, Cheryl.
Cheryl Campbell, if that's what the judge was turning in, when was the policy changed? I'm just curious.
I think you kind of answered that already.
Ms. Campbell, there's you have two different types of positions that you're looking at, but there was really no handwritten policy. It was a go forward and prosper type thing. It was really, that's why we now have a cell phone payment policy to cover these issues.
As of when?
As soon as we get the verbiage complete. So, Lord willing, next Monday. Okay?
You don't have it yet,
right.
All right, so we do need a motion on those 11, if you'd like to remake your motion.
Okay, so I make a motion to pay claim dated 1/25 of 16, claim dated 2/28 of 16.
Let's start over.
Sure.
Okay, now these are going to be paid claims?
These are the paid claims, and I'm going off the claim date, okay? Claim dated 1/25/16. Claim date 2/28/16. Claim date 10/1/15. Claim date 8/6/15.
6/15.
8/6/15. Claim date 6/8/15.
6/8/15.
Yep. Claim date 5/5/15. claim date 1/28 of 15.
12/28 of 15.
Nope, 1. 01/28/15. Claim date 01/31 of 14. Claim date 12/12 of 14. Claim date 09/26 of 14. And claim date 6/27 of 14.
All right, I will second that motion. Any further discussion? All right, it's been moved and seconded to pay the claims for the date stated. All those in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed?
Abstain.
Okay, let the record show the motion carries, and Commissioner Somoza abstains.
Those are the ones that have to be paid. Those are the ones that die. Your lack of information. And these are the ones that have already been paid.
All right. And I have a question while we're moving forward. I did request those call logs. Now, per the open records statutes, since I made those requests at the time the claims were submitted, and there, most of them are in writing, I wouldn't request that for any that aren't in writing. Am I able to get that without paying the back prices, the cost to go back for 2 years for the bills, for the call logs, since the request was made in writing and dated at that time?
I would say you're going to have to pay the back cost from when you retrieve those records.
And why is that?
You or the county.
What? Why should either me or the county do that when the request was made, it just wasn't granted?
Because they didn't pay, so they weren't public records. They were private phone.
Okay.
You pay it today, so now I think there's no dispute over whether it's public record. You've now paid, so you can go back and make those requests, but you're going to have to probably pay whatever it's a fee to retrieve those old records.
All right.
So I would make two suggestions to the commissioners on this. Number one is, we need to go back and find if there are other claims that have been submitted that are not in this pile. So okay. I'm aware of at least four, according to Commissioner Sluder. Okay. September 2015, March, April, and May of this year. And there may be others. So first I would say let's find those claims.
If they exist.
What's that?
If they exist.
If they exist. Secondly, I would say, given that we just had claims all the way back to over two years ago, and the vast majority of the claims that he submitted were not approved, you would have a really hard time defeating the futility argument. And what that means is Commissioner Slifka submitting a claim and the commission saying, no, you didn't submit this whenever point, and you would say, I knew it was futile to submit it because they were being denied. Even though they weren't all denied, the vast majority of them were denied, many of these 11, there's no valid reason why they were denied. And so I would recommend that you, if he submits past claims based on the fact that you didn't submit them because he thought there was no point, they weren't going to get paid, that you pay those claims. And to put this, to just put this in perspective, the three you rejected today, you're talking $60. If we've got four, let's say there's four or five claims out there that he didn't submit, you're talking $100, $80. It really would strike me as counterproductive to this commission to have a knockdown, drag-out fight over less than $200, over claims that, based on a policy that was never written down, that his claims were rejected for a long period of time. There's no reason for it. This is, we have so many big things to do, and so many genuine issues to disagree about. There is no common sense, defensible reason why it took us this long to pay these claims. And I think Commissioner Korthal is for taking this and pushing it through, because this would be an absolutely unnecessary self-inflicted wound to the county. And I would urge us to reject future tendencies or temptations to do the same thing. There's big issues to fight over. Let's fight over those. These little ones, doesn't make any sense.
I agree wholeheartedly for what you just said. And this $400, what it is, it doesn't mean anything. Hell, I lose more money on that on a calf or something in the auction. I mean, that doesn't mean anything. I carry more than that. I'm not gonna say in my shirt pocket all the time. But anyway, it's just the idea of it. That's the thing I wanted
right.
to bring
this,
out.
The second thing I would say,
and
to
I'll
you, Commissioner Sable, but the second thing I would say to you, Commissioner Slipka, is if it's a reasonable request for documentation, then submit the documentation. Don't bow your neck out of stubbornness and not submit the documentation and then gum up the works.
That's why I put all those four pages. Like I said, those first ones, that's what you kept saying, you got to have four pages.
And now,
anyway,
now that Commissioner Ober is requesting these records, those are public records, so submit, you know, do your very best in a very timely manner. Generally 30 days is when people ask to have those records in, to provide those records. And if it's $40 in fees you have to pay to retrieve a record that's 2 or 3 years old, then you're entitled to that reimbursement. But those records now are property of the people of Montana.
So
in other words, your cooperation is essential in getting those records produced.
I'm not going to ask for them.
Well, no, Commissioner Slipka,
yeah.
Commissioner Olbert is going to
request. Yeah, that's fine. You have the whole damn work.
My point is, you're the one that has access to those through your cell phone company. You're the one that's going to have to produce those for her. That's what I'm telling you.
Well, I'm not going to look them up. That's for sure.
Well,
anyway,
you have to look them up, or else, as part of a public records request, I have to do a subpoena for your phone records from your phone company. It'd be the same as if you have a filing cabinet downstairs that's got all your public, you know, county commissioner correspondence in it, and a public member of the public walks in and says, I want to look at it. Open the drawer and say, there you go, don't make a mess. So that's why I'm admonishing everybody here, but for you, the next step is you need to now cooperate and provide those records. It would actually be helpful if you did just a short written request. And for today, day or whatever day you want to do. Okay? This is required by the Constitution of the state of Montana.
Yeah.
That's why I'm okay.
All right. So we do have a question of mileage as well, or mileage and travel reimbursement. This came up, we had 8 minutes left in the meeting, and I did request a little time because I think there's vast misunderstanding on this one. We do have some written policies on this that I think it's important that we look at. We have a budget training. We've had four budget trainings in just the last 2 years, two here in the county and then two in other places. So what we need to talk about is what those budget trainings taught us and how, as managers, we're going to look at those as the policies that we follow. So again, if the commission wants to decide on you know, back paying or not, it's the commission's decision, I suppose. But a lot of this has been brought forth by accounting because they're looking for clarity. What they're being asked to do goes against their training, budget act, and policy that we have. I have here a memo, and I'll give you guys each a copy of this too. But what this is sent out every single year. And what it says is all invoices need to be submitted no later than a date certain in July for the past fiscal year. We then work with the auditors, we close out the fiscal year, and anything from that past fiscal year is done. We have had people come forward, I told this story last week, with claims that were lost, and we said, we, the county, said, no, we're not gonna pay that because it was in the past fiscal year, and this is the policy we follow. So, that's piece one. Piece two is, if you look at the commissioner budget, the first one with all my chicken scratch at the top, sorry about that. If you look down at object code, what you want to look at is commissioners, the general fund, which is 1,000, the commissioners.
Which you call it, page one?
Okay. So chicken scratch was the identifier on that one. If you look at the commissioners budget, which is the right after general fund, and then you look at all the different object codes, you see travel at 370 there? If you go across that line, what you'll find is that we have right now available appropriation $200. And this is as of March 2016. That is all the money we have in the travel object code to spend on travel. So, keeping that in mind, I have just some. Just for fun. This is a series of information that I've shared on this subject, trying to get clarity on how we should move ahead. I agree, I think a calm conversation over this one could be done with each of these in 30 minutes and not ever have spent all these hours. So, the first one is an email with this very subject. If you look at, there's claims behind here. One is for travel reimbursement from 10-1-15. Then there's a couple of MACO receipts. And then there's the memo that you have your own copy of. And then there's another reimbursement for mileage dated 5-1-14. And then there's one for 8-11-14. Okay, so starting with the first one, 10-1-15. That claim was not denied for the mileage. It wasn't denied for the meal per diem. What was challenged was the 165 for the conference. What was submitted was not a receipt that Franklin had paid it, it was a receipt of payment. Hugely different thing. You see mine there on the very bottom? What that states is I also got one, but the county paid mine. For me to have submitted a claim that is identical to Franklin's is deceiving. That is not a receipt that we can refund because what we need is proof that that money was paid to Franklin.
Did the county pay for his registration at that conference?
Let yes, eventually we did.
No, but at that time did it?
No, he opted not to. He didn't go online to register for the conference. He didn't submit a claim to a county. He wrote his own check at the conference the day of registration.
Okay, so
that was his choice.
So he did pay.
He did.
So how is that deceitful?
He didn't provide us a receipt of that.
How is that deceitful?
He didn't provide a receipt. The auditors look for a receipt, especially from elected officials, that a fee has been paid based on that receipt that shows it was paid by Franklin Salifka, accounting that is able to write a check and give it to Franklin.
Okay, but what I understood you to just say is that he provided this receipt showing that the conference had been paid for and that he wrote his own check. Mm-hmm. And that's deceitful. And
no,
that
I didn't say that.
You used the word deceitful.
I did use the word deceitful, but not in that. Not in that.
She called a double dip into the county. She told
so did
if
the county.
If you look at this one, this is my name on it. It is a receipt. If I had submitted this and claimed that I had paid it, and this is all I gave the county, and they paid me, that would be deceitful.
But that's not what he did.
But we don't have any. We didn't have anything else when this claim was denied. But that. But this exactly. We had nothing that showed that Franklin paid it.
You didn't. You didn't call your clerk and go, "Hey, did Commissioner Slipka put this on the county credit card?" No, he didn't. Okay.
That's not how it works, Corey.
But how is that deceitful? That's what I don't understand.
Okay, I'm sorry. I used a word that is unflavorful. The bottom line is, this is not appropriate receipting. And the claim was denied because we didn't have a receipt that showed that Franklin paid it. Okay? That's the bottom line. That claim was then taken and we never saw it again. So that's the reason it was denied. No other reason.
Who took
there was Franklin did. And there was a quote on the bottom of the claim that says, challenge the 165 without receipt, need to provide to be reimbursed. That's all we were looking for. Either that could have been taken off, brought back later, that would have been reimbursed, but it wasn't because the claim was never resubmitted with or without that information. So the second one then, for 5114, there was a note put on it from the accounting office, and it said, waiting for Franklin to bring proof that this commissioner's budget can support this claim. Close to the end of the year, our travel budget shows $200 now, but we need to verify towards the end of the year that we have the budget authority, because if you look at 764005, it says local government officials, get my glasses, local government officials may not make a disbursement or an expenditure or incur an obligation in excess of the total appropriations for a fund. A local government official who violates this is liable for the amount of the excess disbursement, expenditure, or obligation personally. So based on that, we wanted to make sure that there was money in the travel budget. He took the claim, we didn't see it again, it wasn't paid. Then the last one, dated 8/11/14, and it's in the green folder. The reimbursement request was for mileage from the previous fiscal year. It was submitted in August. Our closeout date was the end of July, and the travel mileage reimbursement request was for May 13th, 14th, 20th, June 6th, 10th, and 25th from the previous fiscal year. It had already been closed out, and that's the reason that one was denied. This was a commission decision. It was not my decision, but those are the reasons for those. Now, if there was an error made, educate me. But here's the thing. We were also accused of taking the mileage budget and decreasing it so that it would be harder for Franklin to get his mile reimbursements. I went back, and I also have that for you guys. It's the second sheet that I handed you. This shows the actuals from fiscal year 13, 14, and 15. And what you will see there is the actual from 13 was $1,208. Actual from 14 was $1,200. Actual from 15 was $1,521. And we budgeted in fiscal year 16 for $1,500. We increased that almost every year except for the $8 from fiscal year 13 to 14. So we have tried to accommodate, but when we get to this point of the budget, we have a request for mileage now that is far more than the $200 in our budget for travel. We can remedy this, but it's up to Commissioner Salifka. In order for us to have budget authority to do any payment of anything that goes over the amount in that particular line item, we have to have a budget amendment like we did today at 11 o'clock. If you want to request that more be put in a fund, it's up to that commissioner to determine where it's going to come from, make that request in public, and take that to Debbie to put into a budget amendment for the commission to vote on. Then we can pay those bills. But if we don't get them, if we don't have that communication, we don't know that it's coming, close out the year, and it's done. Okay. That is the reason.
I'm going right back in this double dipping, she called it. And I said to Elaine, I said, should I bring a canceled check? And she said, that'd be fine. I brought, here's a copy of it from my bank statement right here. And Elaine approved that then. I got a check over stop payment on it. And everybody told me, there's no way you can stop payment on a county check. So I held it. I held it. And finally, somebody said, well, you know, 6 months, you can't hold 6 months. So just before the 6 months, I went ahead and cashed it. That's on the so-called double dipping that I was doing. On this budget thing, I went in and talked to Debbie on that. In fact, I got a lot of this stuff here, all of it actually, from Debbie. I go through the claims. I didn't want to make any mistakes. It's easy to make a damn mistake, and I don't want to make a mistake. I went over and over, and maybe I still did somewhere. So. But anyway, on this particular thing on this budget, and she showed me on these line items, she says there's only, we're over it at that time. And she says, well, we do. There's these six line items, and she says,
and there's $125,000 in that. She said, what we do that at the end, we just readjust this in these line items. That's what she told me. I don't know anything else. I could tell you 1,000 things, but I'm not going to sit here and talk and talk and talk.
So that's just the process. It's those particular claims specifically. We got a claim. This, again, is from March. We got a claim in June for miles, and it's 2,000-something. I don't think I have it. But again, with $200, we don't have the budget authority to pay that.
Because they went on it. They've been turning. It never went on. And as far as turning, you know, in my own business, I'm...
We have a process.
They're not putting turning claim. I do work for people all year long. I don't bill until usually December when I'm getting ready to start doing my taxes, and I know that they want theirs, so I send bills. I'm not good at sending out bills, but I've done that hundreds of times, well, all my life, actually. So I might get a little lax, but even so, there's always a document taken, that's the thing.
So with that, as far as the claim for 2016, and there might be in 15, after July, we can still work on those, but Franklin needs to bring to us what he wants to do for the budget amendment. That is not too late.
And he said that it's taken care of. That's what she told me there. That was a year ago. She says, there's all these items here. She says, at the end, we just make a budget amendment. So I never did anything more.
As far as the ones for the past years, if there was an error made, educate me. Help me to understand that. But especially for the one August 14th for the previous fiscal year, that goes against our written policy. And as far as the budget authority, I do think we need to follow that 764005. But again, let me know if there's something I'm misunderstanding there.
Which written policy are you referring to?
This one. All invoices need to be turned in by such and such date.
I always turn them in before the end of the fiscal year.
Because we close out the fiscal year with the auditors, and then that year is done.
I make that as the same point as I do to my customers. I get them a bill before the end of the year. I just might start working January, February for them. But anyway, it's all there. I mean, documentation, it's all there. And whatever's...
This really comes down to just communication. If we just follow the process and do it in public, then there's no issues with any of these, including the one for June. Again, we can go ahead and do a budget amendment with 2 weeks' notice. It's going to be after the closeout date, but if we know that's coming, that's something we can work with. But if we don't even have notice of that, it's very hard for us to just do our job. And as managers, we really do need to follow these policies and practices to the letter for clarity. So again, if you want to take them one at a time, that's fine by me. If they're past dates, that's fine too. Whatever you guys want to do.
I want to know, does the commission intend to be this way for forever?
No, I would like to see more communication so that we can be more of a unit. We're supposed to be managing the business of the county.
Hey, don't worry, ask you a question, you'll have an answer.
So let's just get through this, okay? Number one, Commissioner Over, you cannot say that Commissioner Slifka is being deceitful when he provides a receipt, the receipt that the conference gave him. That is not deceitful. That's the receipt the conference gave him. And he paid with his own check. He paid with his own check. He submitted the receipt that the conference gave him to the county for reimbursement. Where is the deceit in that? There is no deceit in that. Only if he had the county pay and then submitted for a double payment, which you apparently suppose that he did from the outset.
No,
that's not deceitful.
Corey, you're not being fair. You're really
going to lie so much you can't remember what lies.
Okay, you guys, been fighting for years.
I apologized and said I used the wrong word.
Okay.
I will stand by that. I shouldn't have used the word deceitful.
All right. Well, I will withdraw.
Franklin, in a next conference, actually had Karen from Mako sign his receipt. I didn't challenge that. That was fine. The problem is it needs clarity. That's it.
Okay.
That's all I was asking for.
The problem also is this kind of working relationship, we might as well. Why don't you guys just give everything to Commissioner Corthals and let him decide, because you guys are almost always opposite votes, and so he's just a swing vote. I mean, we have to get to a point where you can either work together, tolerate each other, in some way recognize there's a human being underneath those shells, so we can get beyond this. These are easy things. There's hard
yes.
things ahead. These are easy.
That's right.
Yes, so
okay.
Absolutely.
Let's
go ahead and work the problem here.
Okay, so the problem is, number one, I cannot see how in the world that you would challenge that, number one. Number two, Commissioner Slipka, if she challenges it, then the normal rational thing to do would be to go, hey, I paid for this with my own check, here's the receipt, where's my reimbursement? And I don't know if you did that or not.
She was sitting right here with me. Elaine, look, I showed the check. And she was sitting right
oh,
there.
This is the one that was paid and then there was a stop payment on? Is this check?
I think it's the same one. I have to go through all. I can't remember which one. Okay. Sure.
So if that's the case, Commissioner Roemer, I don't know that you would have the authority as a single commissioner to issue a stop payment.
I don't.
This is yours.
That's false.
Yes.
So
that's
let's
false?
Just, yes,
okay,
let's just
well,
move on. I have no idea what he's
okay.
talking about.
If, in fact, that happened, a single commissioner does not have the authority to issue a stop payment on a check that the commission has authorized.
Nor would a
do
single
we all agree
commissioner
on that?
Want to do
we
that.
All agree on that?
Yes.
Okay. Can we just pay number one and move on?
Yes.
What's number one?
Number two.
I thought it had been paid.
I think that one's been paid, finally.
Okay. Well, then,
right.
Gosh, why are we talking about it? Let's
no,
go on to number two.
Well,
number two.
I'm sitting up here, and I don't even know where we're at.
We're on this memo that
okay.
Robert provided. And
number two is 5.
The challenged Mako conference fee
hold on.
From October of 2015.
Are we,
okay.
what's the amount that one?
Time out. Okay, let's all get on the same page here. Okay, are we going to discuss these issues that Chairman Overt submitted, the 1 through 3, the
doesn't
packet that she gave us, or and is that what the green? Because as I went through this, there was two copies of some things and some. So, at a total, I need to know: are we just looking around at 2,615.81?
What I'm hoping to do
is
to provide you some amount of legal advice on this and let you figure it out. I have no intention of going through every one of these mileage claims one by one. And what is not clear to me, and I don't know if somebody can give us an answer easily, is what percentage of mileage claims have been paid and have not been paid over the course of the time that the last couple of years. Does anyone know?
Most of them had been paid in
30.
And that's another thing, the people out there.
Is that these?
I can charge mileage every time I come in a meeting. I don't. If I come in at night for a meeting, I charge. I go to Missoula, the Great Falls.
Yes. I'm going to get to that. Okay. My question is, how many have been paid and how many have been not paid?
There's just two that haven't been paid.
Even just two mileage claims that have not been paid?
But I'd have to look for sure.
We did not have budget authority for the one dated 5/1/14. You see that one?
Yes. What's
we
the amount?
It's a small one, 132. But again, we didn't have budget authority for that one. We needed to do a budget amendment, but that was never brought to the commission.
But then
that needed to be done.
Okay, but then number three is apparently more.
Number one, we're going to.
Number three is more complicated.
Okay,
so let's
so
just
number
stick with
one
number
and
two.
Number one and number two. Number one, we've talked about.
And
let's
it's
go
paid.
Forward.
It's paid.
Okay, number two.
Number one's done.
Number two, I'm going to read you a statute. I know you've all read it, but it bears repeating, apparently. 7-4-2108, mileage allowance for county commissioners. In addition to the salary provided elsewhere, each member of the Board of County Commissioners must, that's what it says, receive a mileage allowance as provided for in other areas where it can calculate, for the distance necessarily traveled in and going to and returning from the county seat and the commissioner's place of residence each day the trip is actually made and while engaged in the performance of official duties. And then it goes into, if they're 50 or more miles away, then they pay for their overnight lodging while they're in the county seat doing business. Because the statute says you have to do your county commissioner business at the county seat, which is Townsend. And then it says, and Commissioner Slifka, listen to this one, all claims for lodging expense reimbursement allowed under this section must be documented by an appropriate receipt. So if there's a request for receipt, produce the receipt.
Yep.
We can all move on.
Got it.
Okay. This says it must, shall be provided for, which means it's a statutory obligation. When you are doing your budgeting process every year, you have to look at statutory obligations. There's statutory obligations for 1,000 things that you have to calculate costs. I would recommend when you do your budget process for next year, you look at and give a reasonable, fact-based estimate of what those travel expenses are going to be, and you put that in your line item for the budget, okay? So then, rather than the big argument over you shouldn't be taking mileage, it doesn't matter if one commissioner or even two commissioners says you shouldn't be doing it, the statute says you shall do it. And even if the commission rejects a legally valid mileage claim, you're gonna pay it anyway, but you're gonna pay it after it goes to a judge and it comes back and then you pay a bunch of lawyer's fees. This makes no sense that this would be a chicken bone stuck in our throat. So I would recommend that you do a budget assessment and figure out what that cost is likely to be for next year, and it's clearly gonna be more than what it was last year. Secondly, Commissioner Obert, I spent 2 hours with Debbie Kelly last week going over the budget. One particular thing that I noticed is that I had a particular expense for something. I went into my budget, I found line items, there were two different line items that fit that cost. So I said, okay, pay half of it out of this line and half of it out of this line, and that left me in the black. Well, she didn't do that. She took it and paid it out of one, so I had excess in one and I had a negative 150% in the other one. And I went to her and I said, what are you doing? Now I'm in the red on this one and I have extra in this one. I wanted you to split it like I said. And she said, it doesn't matter because we do an amendment and we even it out. So long as for your county attorney line item, your main number, you're not over, then you can, so long as it's not some super restricted line, you can use the money and then we will amend it. Same thing goes for the commissioners. You have 410110 commissioners and you have $106,000 or something here. Mm-hmm. And if you're, what was it, $130 over?
No, that was for previous years. We have a $2,000 request and only $200 in budget authority.
Okay, but you have $106,000 total in your line item. So make an adjustment. And if that's not accurate, then you need to get on the same page with your finance officer, because I just sat through 2 hours with her saying, why are you paying it out of this and you're putting me in the red when I asked you to pay it out of this where I had extra money? And she says, it doesn't matter. I move the money and then we do an amendment and it all evens up. So just, I would say, get on the same page with her, and the reason that matters.
We are, and see, here's the difference. You're one, we're three. We have to work together to tell Debbie, you need to do a budget amendment in our budget because we need spending authority in 370 for travel. That's the difference. Without that, Debbie, I asked Debbie, I said, did Franklin ask you for any kind of amendments to cover this? She said no. He didn't talk to us, he didn't talk to Debbie. Nobody knew this bill was coming. Now that the budget amendment was done today, it was advertised 2 weeks ago, that's the issue here. We don't know this is coming, and then all of a sudden, we've got $2,000 of a bill and only spending authority at 200. What you're saying is right. It's just with three of us, it takes, and each of us being one third, it takes another step or two, because we can't singularly do what you can do so easily.
No, my point is she didn't do what I wanted to do. She went and did whatever she wanted to and paid it out of what funds she felt was appropriate, and then said, it doesn't matter if it's negative, I'll submit something later to the commissioners to balance it. My point is, she's interpreting that to mean these sub-items, 370, 380, 398, 940, probably not 940, that's machinery, whatever, she's saying she does not interpret those as restrictive so long as it's within the overall commissioner's budget. If you've got the authority, you pay it and you adjust it. But I would add to that. Well,
we need to work with her. We need to work with her on that.
Okay.
Because
that's
contrary to all the trainings.
Well,
now, you weren't able to make those trainings.
But I had the same conversation with her, and I told her I wish.
Right, and
do
I
this.
Think there's some misunderstanding there. So let's get together and understand that with her, and maybe with somebody else as well. Department of Admin just did a training.
Okay, that's not my point. My point is this. My point is, this goes to the second part, where you're saying, Commissioner Slifka, it's your obligation to go find the money to pay your travel and reimbursement. I would submit to the commission that that's improper. And the reason that's improper is if you are putting the onus upon, and it could be any commissioner for any reimbursement, you went to a training at Great Falls for Mako, and you had $300 in lodging because it was a four-day training, and come back, sorry, Nick, we don't have the money. You need to go find the money. Or the same with Commissioner Obert or something else. The point is, if as a commission, you are now putting the onus upon the person who is supposed to receive that money, that they need to go out, find that amendment, make that motion themselves for their own benefit, the better answer is that you extend the courtesy of, I'm not going to make you vote for money that we're going to pay to you, Nick. I'm going to do it because I recognize, by statute, we must pay that mileage reimbursement. What I have observed in the past is the commissioner sitting here and an attempt, and almost this argument that's turned into a public shaming attempt between the two of you. And that's improper. It's only improper because it makes you have to go find money for the taxpayers to pay you back rather than another commissioner doing it as a county obligation. But it further erodes the decorum of this body.
Corey, that's also against what we do. We've never asked somebody to
then
go find the money.
Then change what we do. I would recommend we change what we do because there's a lot of
Franklin
things we do that
Debbie?
Is not.
I did talk to Debbie.
He knew that was coming. She didn't know anything about it to make a switch in the budget to show that budget authority. There needs to be that communication.
My point is
he doesn't have to work it out with us if he doesn't want to. He can go to Debbie and she can talk to us. That's fine. The thing is we don't know that's coming, so we don't know to put the money in there. And finding the money, you don't go out and find it on the money tree in the backyard. You look in our budget and you make analysis. Oh, this one has extra, we're way low, and you switch it around. You can work with Debbie on that. That's fine. I don't really care.
All right. I'm extraordinarily frustrated right now.
Me too.
Because this is absolutely unnecessary. This is back in that same bag of unnecessary fights over, frankly, we are talking about peanuts here compared to what this county spends on a regular basis. And the root of the issue, the root of the issue is the relationship among the three people on that side of the table. In this case, two. Commissioner Courtball's out of it. I'm getting the look up there. What I'm suggesting we do, I am not managing, I didn't want to manage the symptoms of the problem. All these are symptoms of the problem. The underlying problem, two things primarily. Number one, and definitely the big dog in this whole fight, is the relationship between the commissioners. But the second thing is what I addressed the commission about a couple of weeks ago, which is we have many practices in this county that have been unwritten, that have been hazy, that have been handshake, that have been a lack of understanding. Not everybody's on board with whatever the policy and procedure is. And that has led to a lot of these misunderstandings. And I'm recommending that we, to the extent we can solidify those, we do. I'm glad you guys are doing the phone thing. To the extent we can reduce those to writing and make those an official policy, we do. There's some that you're not going to be able to do that. And that's where you need to have a respect and a decorum that will lubricate the process so we can get through these. I would urge you, Commissioner Obert, not to put up the same last ditch fight on some of these mileage things as you did on the phone things, because I don't think that it's a winning proposition. The statute says
I don't care if we pay it or not. I have some questions. I asked you. I said, if I misunderstand something, educate me. That's what I've been asking for today.
Okay.
I didn't realize the printed, superseded precedent. I know that now. Let's go ahead and work constructively and take care of this stuff, because I have been working off of budget trainings, policies, and written memos on every decision that I have made, and I am one-third of this commission. So there was at least one other commissioner that agreed with me. So to the 5114, is that the pleasure of the commission to just pay that? It was a pretty small bill. I'm sure we can find the money somewhere, but one thing I want you to educate me on, Corey, is how does the statute you read about the mileage square with the statute that says 764005, local government officials may not make a disbursement or an expenditure or incur an obligation in excess of the total appropriations for a fund. A local government official who violates this is liable for the amount of the excess disbursement, expenditure, or obligation personally. So it seems to me that, you know, the two are not necessarily contrary to each other. One says you will pay it, but the other one says you will pay it as long as you have budget authority.
Yeah, I guess I don't see the contradiction.
I don't either.
So put the budget authority in there in order to pay it.
Exactly.
And so,
but
that's
that,
okay, but that's
that
not, but that's not what happened. That what
it
happened?
Is.
No, no.
It
what
is.
Happened was prior to, even up to the end of last year, we had a commission that, in reality, you control. And on many occasions,
I think that's an affront to Elaine, and that's unfair. That is way unfair. She would take offense to that, so do I.
She shouldn't.
If we counted the votes, and we just did a simple mathematical formula, your view of actions prevailed, I would say, over 3/4 of the time. My point. Okay,
both
so
the same training.
Okay, so the two of you agree then.
Okay.
The point is that in that process, I think you got on the wrong side of the issue on this mileage reimbursement, and for whatever reason, there was an inability to say the statute says we must pay, so we're going to find the money, make an amendment, and pay. And again, the issue is it's a tiny bit of money compared to what we're really dealing with, and we're spending all this time and digging up 2-year-old records on it.
That's
I would just
fine.
Say we resolve it and move forward. So
we can pay the number two. That, you know, $132, I don't know that there was budget authority, but let's just pay it because it's a small amount. I'm fine with that as long as that is in precedent setting.
Right, so I guess this is what needs to be nailed out, okay? The current commission, right now, here and now, current commission, there's mileage reimbursement is not done as statute is stated. Okay? I'm not here to bust anyone or say I don't agree with anything. This is what needs, I guess, to fix the problems that we have. Okay? If we all sit on different boards, correct? So, I make a Johnson to Helena to sit on for a meeting. 9 times out of 10, I don't do mileage. I've not done mileage. Sort of like law enforcement. You just don't do certain things just because it's part of your job. So I'm not against anyone that decides that, hey, I'm gonna do mileage. That's their right by law. So I guess I say all that to say this. Is there a way, because we are required to do quite a bit as commissioners, go to this meeting, go to that meeting, because you really can't estimate, okay, say Franklin's going to go to 5 meetings this week. Chairman Obert's going to go to 8 meetings this week. I have 2 meetings this week. How do you budget for mileage reimbursement according to that statute when we don't know how many meetings we have throughout a monthly basis or a yearly basis to fiscally cover what is mandated by statute?
That's right.
Do you understand my dilemma here?
I do.
Okay. So how would you suggest fixing that problem? Because, okay, Chairman Olbers said, let's just pay the $132. I would go along with that. It's $132. Whether the policy was followed, I'm not here to disperse any of that. We just need to move forward and build so we can move forward as a united group. Okay, so how, because we are in the budget season, and I don't want to get too far off task here, because we just we squashed number one and two on this list here, and how do you budget for that when you don't know? And you're talking about, for example, $1,035 for just one trip.
Let me explain that to you, Nick. That was from the first year to the end. I only put it in a claim reserve once in a while.
Okay.
So that's why but everything's documented.
Oh yeah, no, I'm not, but that's the point I'm trying to make is, if he does it every quarterly or every fiscal year, okay, that's fine. But again, that's still left with a task of claims that Chairman Obert's gonna have, claims that I'm gonna have, or whoever takes